Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Merry Christmas, everybody. God bless you. You're welcome in Jesus' name. Thank God for this privilege to come your way again and bring Jesus Christ into your homes. God bless you. You're highly welcome for this special Christmas message with Pastor Joshua Bruno. We thank God for this opportunity and this privilege. It is a blessing. Hallelujah. You know, so 2020 years ago, Jesus was born. It is a historical truth and historical fact. And we thank God because that birth is what has brought change that we need in humanity today, that has brought us a hope that the world needs. And that is what I want to just share with you a little bit today on, and just by the help of the Holy Spirit, be able to express what is in the heart of God for us today. It is a special day, and Jesus Christ is the reason for the season. Hallelujah. And we thank God because it is God that has made all of this to be possible. Hallelujah. Praise God. I bring you the good news. Christmas is a symbol, an expression, a thing of good news. That is what it represents. It represents the good news because Jesus is the news of Christmas. Hallelujah. And we see that this was made possible by the plan of God, the intentional plan of God to restore man to himself. Hallelujah. So today, God has given us something to live for. That is what I want to talk to you about. Christmas is a message from God telling us we have something to live for. Hallelujah. We have something to live for. We have something to look forward to. We have something for which we live. Hallelujah. Without that, life would be an express journey to nowhere. It would just be an express journey to nowhere. So I want you to understand this truth today, and we're going to begin. I'm going to give you a scripture to address what I just said. In the book of Luke chapter 2 from verse 6, we're just going to read a few verses there. In the book of Luke chapter 6, we see that the story of Jesus began. The story of this good news began. The story of this good news began. And we are seeing it now from the perspective of Luke, the physician. In the book of Luke, we go to Luke chapter 2 from verse 6. And we see that from there began the story of the good news. Hallelujah. And I will just read some verses there for you, and I will call them as I read them. We'll just start with verse 6 and 7. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. That is speaking of Mary. Verse 7. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn. Let us just go to verse 9 after that. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of God shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, verse 10 now, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings. This is the good news. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. Verse 12, and this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Verse 13. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. On earth peace, goodwill toward men. This is the good news. God had a divine plan to bring us back into relationship with him with the end goal of peace. The end goal of peace. But along that path, God has also given us something to live for, to be able to arrive at that place of peace. That is the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is a great news. The angel came, saw the shepherds, and it is very symbolic when he saw the shepherds because he speaks of Jesus Christ as the good shepherd. So they met these shepherds and told them, the angel met the shepherds and told them, there is a babe that is born. You will find him wrapped in swaddling clothes in a manger. And reflecting the glory of God, he's saying that they sent to them on earth peace. Glory to God in the highest and on earth peace. And when they were saying that, the host of the heavens, the angels in heaven, not just the angels in heaven, all the host of the heavens, that means the seven spirits before the throne of God, the 24 elders, all of the host in the heavens, all of them joined together, every entity in heaven was so joyful at this great news that mankind now has an opportunity to be restored back to God in fellowship and relationship. Hallelujah. This is good news. This is good news. And God gave us this so that we have something to live for. If that is not the case, life will be miserable, because we can walk, we can toil, and then it is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. That means after we have toiled on this earth, we have lived and done everything, it ends up in nothing. Just like Mark chapter 8, verse 36 tells us, it says, what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? You see, God didn't want that to be our portion, so he made this provision. He made this exceptional plan of redemption through the birth of Jesus Christ. Now, indicative to know is that this Jesus is the Christ. He is the Son of God. That is, he is the Messiah. And everyone that believes in him gets eternal life, is born into the family of God, is written in the book of life. This is wonderful truth. This is good news. Because without that, we have no inheritance in the kingdom of God. Now, I want to tell you something very supernatural and very powerful today about this. I'm bringing you this great Christmas message, that in this good news, in this event of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, there are powerful things that God brought to us called virtues. Virtues: faith, hope, love, and peace. Faith, hope, love, and peace. In the coming of the Son of God, as we have just read, and I would love to give you so many scriptures, but I just want to be brief. In this message we just read, we see something here. Sinful man, that why would God be mindful of him? Mortal man, that who came from dust and to dust will return. God looked down from heaven, loved him so much, and said, I want to keep this relationship that was lost in the original times that I made, in the beginning. I want to have that relationship. And God said, I'm going to give myself. Listen. God said, I'm going to give myself for that relationship. That is what he did. Now, look at what God did that is different from what he did with those people that came before us, like Abraham. God gave to Abraham a promise. If you go to the book of Hebrews, God said to Abraham, in order to prove to Abraham his credibility, in order for God to prove to Abraham his credibility, hallelujah, God swore to Abraham by his word, by himself. That is what God gave to Abraham. But something more powerful happened here. To us, God not only gave, please, I want you to give me that camera. God not only gave us that credibility of his word and his name, God gave himself. I said, God gave himself. God gave himself. God gave something greater than what he gave to our fathers. He gave himself to put into effect, to put into reality this relationship with him, for us to be one with him. And we see that all through scripture. We see that all through scripture. Hallelujah. We see that all through scripture. This is powerful. And I'm going somewhere to tell you this. Look at that. This is so powerful. And all of it is for one goal, so that we experience peace. So we have something to live for. That means every day we wake up, like we have Christmas right now, we are celebrating this powerful sacrifice that God made, because there is something to live for. There is something in it for us. God gave us something to treasure. God gave us something to look forward to. Remember that the fathers before us, Abraham and all the prophets and all of them, they had this powerful truth they knew about, but they couldn't see it. They were looking forward to it. But better for us, God came himself to make it available. We have it right here before us, with us. Remember that one of the names of Jesus, remember that the angel, when he came, he said, his name shall be called Emmanuel. His name shall be called Jesus, for he shall deliver his people from their sins. What is the meaning of the name Emmanuel? It means God with us. It means God is no longer far away. It means God is no longer somebody we need to seek, run around and make all kind of oblations to be able to find. Yes, he hides himself, but he made a provision for him to be found, and that is in his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Paul said that God is seen in the face of Christ, the glory of God, seen in the face of Christ. So we have God in us. We have God with us. He is not far away. We can call on him and he will hear us. He is right here with us because of this powerful sacrifice of love. So we see these virtues available. Faith. Now we have faith. We have faith. We can call on him, believing that he will hear us. Just by simple believing. Another word for that believing is to trust in him. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, if you read 11 and 13, it says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, and whosoever believes on him shall never be put to shame. What is God saying? God is saying, if you put simple trust in the birth and death and resurrection of Jesus, in the birth, death and resurrection of Jesus, you will be saved. You will be saved. But again, even in this life, you will never be put to shame. That is hope. That is faith. That is a powerful truth. So you listening to me right now, I thank God for your life. And I know that you are rejoicing hearing this wonderful good news. That God orchestrated a supernatural event so that we can come back into relationship with him and have something powerful to live for. By the grace of the Lord, this is possible in your life today in Jesus' name. Thank God for the salvation of mankind. Hallelujah. I want to just show you something very powerful about this powerful something that God gave us to live for, the significance of it. Hallelujah. It's so powerful that Paul boasted about it. Paul boasted. He used the gospel to boast. He said, I am not ashamed of this gospel, because in this gospel, there is something to live for. There is a hope that I cannot have out there, that nobody can give me. There is a joy nobody can give me, which is called the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians 5:22, there is a peace nobody can give me. There is something I have to live for. And God did it by himself. By himself, not by somebody else. By himself. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So I want you to see something about Christmas. I want to give you two fundamental truths that is reflective from what I've been talking about. From the coming of the Lord. Two fundamental truths. Number one is that Christmas has a purpose. Christmas has a purpose. Number two is that Christmas has value in it. The values are what I just started telling you about, the virtues that came with Christmas, which is faith, which is hope, which is love, which is peace. Remember that the gospel, I have told you, is all of its destination. Everything that I am telling you about, the destination of it is love. For God so loved the world that he gave Jesus, that Jesus came, and whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is the destination of the gospel. From Genesis to Revelation, everything that God did was about his love, the expression of his love, giving himself. That is the destination of the gospel. The other thing I want you to know about the gospel is that the gospel is the position of the gospel is faith. Position of the gospel is faith. It means everyone that puts faith in God has a place in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. For whosoever believes in him shall not perish. That is the position of the gospel. And I want to let you know something else. The gospel has as its reward hope. Hope is the reward of the gospel. What is that? What does that mean? It means that for believing in God, there is a reward. For having a hope that there is something to live for, there is a reward. So the hope of the gospel is its reward. Another thing I want you to know about this event that happened is that it has an end. It has an end. It has a place where we are going to. That is peace. Because the coming age and everything that we're experiencing in Christ Jesus, even beginning right now, is peace. So the destination of the gospel is love. The hope of the gospel is its reward. And the position of the gospel is faith. And the end of the gospel is peace. Somebody say hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. These are the values of the gospel. Now, what is the purpose of Christmas? What is the purpose of Christmas? Because we have seen the value of Christmas. The value of Christmas is what I just told you about. Let us just talk about hope and love, for example. If you're sitting right now, before I get into the purpose of Christmas, if you're sitting right now, have you expressed love to someone? Because I want you to know that in this value of Christmas that we talk about, when we talk about love, when we talk about hope, have you also expressed what God did for you to someone else by giving to someone of your substance what God gave you? Because now that brings us into the purpose. The purpose of Christmas is giving. The purpose of this Christmas is sharing. The purpose of Christmas is bringing people into fellowship, into harmony. That is the purpose of Christmas. Christmas means love. It means sharing. It means giving. That is what God expressed by himself. Something better than what the prophets that came before us, even God. God gave to Abraham a word. He swore by himself, by oath, by his word, by his name, by himself. But to us, God not only showed us the unchanging nature of his will, of his counsel, God died himself in the person of Jesus. He became man so that we become sons of God. He became man so that we become sons of God. Look at that. God became man so that man can become the sons of God. That is what happened. So Christmas is about values and it has a purpose in it. I want to really talk a little bit about that purpose. I want to share with you a little bit about that purpose. Hallelujah. Just say a little bit things about that purpose of Christmas. Amen. When we look at this purpose, for example, if you have a widow around you, or a young widow, or you know a friend that you have been bitter about, this is the right time to show the purpose of Christmas. Practically, not in word, but in deed. Christmas is not only what you say. Christmas is not only the clothes you buy for yourself, the Christmas tree you put in your home, or the gifts you buy and give to those that mean to you. It is also the opportunity to share with people you don't love or you don't like. I want to use the word people you don't like, because you may not necessarily love everybody, because sometimes it is not, you just can't find it in yourself, even though I encourage you to do so. But you don't just like them, you don't just want to have anything to do with them. This is the time to pick up that phone. If God has announced his goodness, he not only announced it and put it into effect by angels, he made it a reality by the birth of his son Jesus. Now let us see it in white and black on paper. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. We'll just look at that together. We'll round up. Amen. Praise God. And then use another scripture to show you what Jesus perfectly did for you. 1 Peter chapter 1. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. If you're there, you can just put an amen to that right there.
Amen.
This is beautiful. Jesus is good. God is good. Amen. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. God is good all the time. All the time. God is good. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. This is beautiful what God did for us. Just want to give you some few scriptures to show you the perfect will expressed in the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to look at that, Peter, and then we're going to look at also 2 Corinthians, and then I'll be rounding up. Amen. So let me just look at that. 1 Peter, I want to show you that. Chapter 1 from verse 1 to 3. 1 Peter chapter 1 from verse 1 to 3. Now let us look at that. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers, which is us, but he was speaking specifically to people in Pontus at the time, and Galatia, and Cappadocia, and Bithynia. Verse 2. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied to you. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy have begotten us unto a lively hope. Hallelujah. Has begotten us. Another translation will say, has given us new birth. Hallelujah. Has given us new birth unto a living hope, unto a lively hope, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now let us add verse 4. To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Wow. Look at verse 5. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. This is powerful. Can't get any better than that. God sent Jesus, his son, so that you will have a life that will never perish, a living hope that never fades away. So you have something to live for. That is the good news I have brought you today from the Lord. You have something. Your faith has something as its reward. There is a living hope for you. That hope will never fade. It will never perish. So you are living for something. You can touch yourself right now and say, wow, Wow, I have something to live for. I am living for something. That is the message I brought you. That is the good news. I have something I am living for. As a Christian who has believed, and if you haven't, please, today is that day of salvation. Today is the day to say, yes, Lord. Today is this to say, Jesus, come into my heart. Thank you for Christmas. Oh, I didn't understand everything about Christmas. I just knew it is about nice clothes and good times with family and eating good food, some of the best food. But it is much more than that. It is about a relationship with God Himself. So I have something to live for. So every day I wake up, even if the enemy, the devil wants to put a lie in my heart and in my ear and in my mind, I remind myself, I am living for something. I have a better hope. I have a living hope that will never fade away. It will never perish. It will never ever perish. So brothers, sisters, friends, Christmas is a beautiful time to celebrate this wonderful blessing. Hallelujah. And not only to celebrate it ourselves, but to share that love with other people, to bring that value to other people, the values of love, the values of peace, the values of hope, the hope that will never fade away. Somebody say amen. Now let us see that really done through the body of Christ Himself. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. How was that possible? What made that possible? 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I will just read one or two verses there. Okay, let us just start from verse 18. Look at this beautiful thing that has happened here. Wow. Just look at that. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. This made that living hope possible. And all things are of God, who have reconciled us to Himself. All things, all of this Christmas is possible because of God who gave Himself. All of these things are of God who hath reconciled us to Himself by Jesus Christ and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Let us stop there for a moment. I'm about to wrap up and I'm bringing the message home to you today. I'm bringing this message home to you today. Everything I've been saying is now coming together. You have something to live for that is made possible by God, who gave you a better sacrifice than He did to Abraham. To Abraham, He even demanded something. He demanded His son to prove His faith. To you, God is not demanding anything. He is only calling you to Himself, by Himself. Wow, you didn't get that. To Abraham, God demanded something to prove His faith. And God had to prove to him the unchanging nature of His counsel. By His word and by Himself. But not giving Himself, just by His word and by Himself. But to you, God made it a little bit much better. He didn't ask you for anything. He gave you this opportunity for reconciliation by Himself. He gave Himself. He sealed this redemption, this reconciliation with His own blood. By Himself. This is what He's saying here. God not only reconciled you to Himself, but He also now is giving you the opportunity to say, you can bring others to be reconciled to Him. That is the value of Christmas. That is the purpose of Christmas. The love, the hope, the faith, the peace that comes with it. And then the ability to be able to share that with those around you. And this is made possible by God Himself. Now look at verse 19. To wit that God was in Christ. God was in Christ, which is what I was telling you about in another place Paul called it, the glory of God seen in the face of Christ. That God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and had committed to us this word of reconciliation. God is not asking you anything. He is not even counting your mistakes and your sins against you. Rather, He is putting them away, not even counting them, nailing them to the cross of His Son. And now, telling you, you also have the same opportunity to share that purpose with other people, to share that value with other people. What is God talking about before I finish right here? It means that the birth of His Son was for a divine purpose. The moment His Son was born, the divine plan was His Son would be killed at some point. The blood would be the seal of the redemption for you and me. What it means is that the moment Jesus was hung on that cross, every sin of the world was put on him. It means that God was looking on Jesus at that very moment and saying that every sin that everybody will commit, would ever commit, has ever committed, is now on Jesus. That is what God did. That is what is the reconciliation talked about right here. Reconciliation. Peace made by blood. Peace made by blood. Now let me finish about that. Verse 20. Because of that, now he said, then we are ambassadors for Christ. We are not messengers of Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead. Just like Jesus, we pray you. I am praying just like I am Jesus now. That is what Paul is talking about. To be reconciled to God. That you have no excuse not to be reconciled to God. Now verse 20. Because it's so evident, he now said, for he had made him, for God had made Jesus his son, to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. I want you to hear me today. This is the greatest event of all time. Oh, hallelujah. I'm rounding up right now. This is the greatest event of all time. Because of this sacrifice, we have a living hope. We have something to live for. Something that will neither perish nor fade away. Something that will neither perish nor fade away. Will never fade away. Remember that the things that are seen will fade. The things that are unseen will endure. And that is the work of the cross. That in you, God has done something no man can do. By the birth of Jesus. By the birth of Jesus. Jesus has come. And because Jesus has come and died and rose again, we have a hope that will never perish. So we have a life. We have a life and something to live for. Praise the Lord. Please, this is your message today for Christmas. And this is your message for the world. And the message for your friends. And the message for your family to say, I have something to live for. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Before you go, I want to say Merry Christmas again. And I want to encourage you to share with others the love of Christ and to give to the body of Christ. You can give a special offering to God Movement, to Pastor Joshua Bruno's ministry, and to even your ministry, wherever you are, if you're not in Germany, in our church or in our ministry, but to wherever you worship. It is a time to sow a special Christmas gift. You can send it to the, go to our website and you can say, I was blessed today. And you can give that special Christmas seed. But beyond that, you can also share with others around you. I look forward to hearing from you. I love you with the precious love of Jesus Christ. I will see you by the hand of the Holy Ghost in the new year. God shall prosper you. No evil shall come near you nor your dwelling place. And all the blessings, every blessing of the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ shall abide with you. And remain in you and with your family. I love you. God bless you. Shalom.